please be upstanding? Thank you. Welcome again, everybody. We're going to start with a couple of songs. So let's invite our band up for some music. Please stay standing.
Thank you. Next song will be Pass It On.
Shout it.
Here and online, we are maxed out online. We can't get any more in. We should have had a bigger account. So yes, so many people around the world would love to be here to share this time with the Crosthwaite family: Ashley, Patrick, Melanie, Evie, Tom. But they can't be here for obvious reasons, time and space. But they are online, some of them, and we hope that today will be a celebration of Susan's life. Susan, from the songs that we sang, I could tell immediately these are Susan's songs. Yeah, she wanted to pass on God's love, and she gave her life for God. Yeah, so thank you, Susan. Please join me in prayer. Our beloved Heavenly Parent, thank you so much that we can be gathered here today, the 23rd of November, 2022, to say farewell to our dear sister, Susan Crosthwaite, who has given her all for your sake. Every moment, every day, she was thinking of you. She was thinking of your children lost in the world that you wanted to reach out to, and she did her utmost in whatever way she could find to reach out to us, to love us and to encourage us. We are so grateful. Many of us are here today because of Susan. Many of us survived till today because of Susan and the Crosthwaite family. And we owe them a great debt of gratitude. We want to intercede on her behalf as she ascends to your side, Heavenly Parent. She has been an exemplar of love on this earth. And if love is the atmosphere of the spirit world, and it is, then Susan is ready to breathe in your love, breathe in the love in the spirit world. But she doesn't want to rest, I'm sure. She wants to continue working on this earth with her family, with our community, with the nation, with all nations of the world, to bring your peace on this earth. And as we lead up to Christmas, we're thinking about these things, all the wars in the world and how your son Jesus came to bring peace, which is still not here, but you have been working tirelessly from the moment of the fall. You've been working to return this world back to you, and Susan has been a champion in that work. Susan and Ashley together have worked all around the world, in Russia, in America, Australia, some parts of the world which are so inhospitable. Even in the shadow of Chernobyl, they were working. Heavenly Parent, these are your champions on earth. And as she comes to your side in the spirit world, I know you'll be so grateful and joyful to receive her, and so will our true Father. And we are mourning now because it's natural we are losing the presence of someone we love dearly. But we know in our faith, we know in our whole beings that Susan is still with us. Even today, she has appeared to many. She has been felt by many. And in the years to come, she will still be an inspiration to many. And she'll be working substantially on this earth for the sake of your will. Heavenly Parent, please guide and protect all our proceedings today. We pray that you can be at the center of all our thoughts, all our interactions, as Susan would have wanted. And she's here with us today, the star of this show today. Her music, her warmth, her smile should fill our hearts with joy today as we say goodbye for now to her. So please receive our report and prayer in my name, Aja and Nitya Mold of a Central Blessed Family, Arjun. So thank you once more. We're going to have a cup at the Wonjon ceremony later today. Our pastor emeritus, Franklin Fortune, will be managing that part of the service. And from now, I'm going to hand over to our senior pastor, Dr. David Hanna, to continue on today's formalities. David.
Thank you, and good morning, everyone, family, friends, brothers and sisters. The Seonghwa ceremony that we're sharing in this morning, it's in large part a celebration of the life of the person who has passed away, or as we say, ascended. And the literal meaning of the Korean word is heavenly harmony. Heavenly harmony. So if we think of it that way, it can be seen and experienced as more profound, more enlightening, perhaps even more beautiful than a person's wedding. At their wedding, Susan and Ashley, they were just starting out to build their beautiful relationship that made them a couple. My wife and I were reflecting that when we think of Susan and Ashley, it's always Susan and Ashley, right? It's a measure of their love and the perfection of their relationship. So you know, they were starting out to build that relationship, and from that they raised a family. But now looking back, we may all be surprised when we hear testimonies and some of the words of appreciation that are coming today. I had a little insight into some of those. So we'd be surprised just how much Susan made of her life and how determined she was to live a good life by giving so completely to others. Let's listen to the eulogy so we can sit and listen together. A eulogy for Susan Crosthwaite, this very dear and precious soul. This will be read by her good friend and brother in the spiritual life, Simon Roselli. Simon.
Susan Crosthwaite, a life of living and speaking love. Susan was born on the 17th of April in 1955 in a town of Kahuna, Victoria, in Australia, to her beloved parents, Stuart and Helen Hodges. After the death of her mother, when Susan was only 11 years old, she was always grateful to her older sisters, Jenny and Sally, who, being much older than herself, took a motherly role, deeply loving their little sister. Susan attended Geelong High School for Girls, where she excelled in studies, and upon graduation went to Melbourne to study nursing. It was there that in February 1974, she met Annette Kamger, who had come from Germany some months before as a missionary representing the Unification family to introduce the divine principle to the country for the first time. After studying the principle together with Annette, Susan became the first sister to join the Unification family in Australia. And from that time on, almost 50 years ago, Susan pioneered many cities all over her home country. Susan had a gift for music and played both piano and guitar, as well as singing and composition, often writing her own lyrics. She was always generous in sharing these gifts with friends, old and new, and those who were blessed to hear her voice were always uplifted. In 1980, Susan came to New York for a visit, and while there, she was introduced to Ashley by Reverend Father Seonghwa Moon, and they decided to get engaged. Not long after this, Susan returned to Australia and then traveled to the Solomon Islands, where she introduced the principle for the first time and did service work for IRFF, the International Relief Friendship Foundation. In 1982, Susan returned to the United States, and some months later, she and Ashley attended their marriage blessing ceremony on the 1st of July. For a while, Susan worked in the financial sector in Manhattan while living in her little apartment in Brooklyn, where she met many new friends. Eventually, Susan joined Ashley in Knights Valley, near Santa Rosa, California. For 5 years, Susan taught and counseled hundreds of people, young people from all over the world, as she and her husband worked as directors of education for the West Coast. From 1990, Susan moved to the USSR, and she pioneered and taught in schools and colleges far afield as Vladivostok, Yaroslav, Latvia, and finally, St. Petersburg. Her beloved son, Patrick Alyosha, was born on the 10th of December in 1991. And at that time, her spiritual daughter, Sasha Yanishkaya, joined the family as they traveled from place to place as a nanny to Alyosha. From early in 1995, Susan traveled to the UK for medical treatment, and eventually the family settled there in the South London area. Susan longed for a second child, for a sibling for Patrick, and against all the odds, at the age of 43, her daughter Melanie was born on the 20th of August in 1998, to whom Susan often referred to as the flower of my heart. Susan achieved so many things in her life, but the one she was most proud of was being a mother, a role in which she invested her whole heart. She introduced Patrick to his wife, Ivana, on Valentine's Day in 2015, and over the years became a great friend and second mother to her. Despite being an ocean away, a friendship, though short, will be sorely missed. This is the type of friend Susan is, and that her love spans the globe. For the next 20 years or more, Susan worked as a marriage counselor and a therapist and developed the marriage enrichment seminars, which she brought all over the world and helped so many families in overcoming their various challenges. Susan was constantly learning new things and always educating herself. She was an emotion code practitioner, a therapist, a life coach, and much, much more. She had a gift of finding the good in every person, and had a gift of being an empathetic listener and a wise counsel. While raising her family, Susan also worked on peacemaking projects in Israel, Korea, and throughout Europe. In recent years, Susan was able to publish her book, Loving Living Words. And even after having cancer, she traveled all over Albania, sharing her compassion and wisdom, and served the mayor of Croydon in 2019 to 2020 as the interfaith ambassador. Susan was supported many activities of the Universal Peace Federation, even during the last 2 years of her life, when her illness was causing her so many troubles. She always greeted everyone with smiling eyes, not wanting her friends and family to worry, always interested in their lives, helping them overcome their troubles. Over the last few months, Susan grew weaker, and it was clear that she might not get to Christmas, but she endured the great suffering. Without complaining, and even being grateful for every help she received from dear friends, doctors, and nurses. But most of all, she was grateful for Melanie's support through these difficult times. As with being in the medical profession herself, as a midwife, she understood more than almost anyone what she was going through. Susan passed into the spiritual world on the 16th of November, with Ashley holding her hand. Susan will be dearly missed by all those who are blessed to know her and had their lives touched by her love and kindness. Anyway, just on a personal note, thank you for coming. I met Susan 35 years ago, in California. She was like the camp mother. And I guess it comes from her heart, where she was a nurse and she wanted to go into caring for other people. But she was like a mother hen, and she embraced. And about 5 years later, I remember she was, when she was pregnant with Patrick, she had to lie down for 4 months. But still, she was trying to help people, counsel people, and support them. And recently, I think she was almost a year in bed. But again, she continued that. And people came to see her. But also, she reached out to people across the world through Zoom and other internet things. So she reached out to people in the world. So she was always helping others, and that was her heart. Like I say, even when she was ill and there was a pandemic, she found a way to support the mayor of Croydon by putting donation boxes in places, and no one would ever say no to her. They couldn't say no to her. She started a table tennis thing, where people would go to the park to play table tennis. They weren't allowed to socially distance, but she found a way that they would make a donation to support the mayor. So I thank you, Susan. She left the world in a better place than she found it. And I say farewell, dear sister, but not goodbye.
Thank you, Simon, and thank you to the family for preparing those very beautiful words. You know, even those whom we count as close friends, we never seem to know them well enough, do we? So at these moments, and sometimes we might feel it's too late, what we hear surprises us. But actually, I don't think it's too late. This is why we're here today, actually. And I remember when you tried to compliment Susan, she would always blush so innocently, you know? And, you know, blushing is automatic. You can't control that, right? So this was her. So, well, we won't see her blushes today, right? Unless you're very spiritually open. So she's we're going to hear a lot of nice but true things about this wonderful soul. We have some readings there on your program sheet if you'd like to follow, and they're specially chosen for today, one from the New Testament and one from the words of Father Moon. These will be read by another good friend and companion of Susan's on life's journey. That's Lance Gardner. Thank you, Lance.
I'd like to offer three readings selected from the words of Jesus Christ and Father Moon. The first is from John chapter 13, verse 14. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? Second reading is from Father Moon. A Seonghwa ceremony is like a butterfly coming out of its cocoon, getting rid of a shackle and becoming a new body and a new existence, a new entity. It is exactly the same kind of process. Death is like a rebirth or a new birth into another world. The third reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 9 to 13. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Thank you.
Thank you, Lance. At this point, I'd like to say a few words, a short homily on the meaning of this occasion. That second reading there described this farewell ceremony as marking a change, a time of change, getting rid of the shackle of this physical body with its potential for sickness and its temporary nature. And it likened it to a process of rebirth. This is not an explanation that's really at odds with nature. It's a most natural process. But like giving birth, it can be very painful. Yet it brings about a great transformation, a new and changed state of life. In nature, there are extraordinary examples of metamorphoses. And I'm sure for those creatures whose lot it is to go through those kind of changes, they don't comprehend it until it happens. So such is the emergence of a butterfly from a cocoon. So nature is amazing. The purpose of this physical life for human beings is to grow and to develop our spirit. That's our inner self, the person who we are, and the spirit that will survive after our physical death, when we no longer need the help of the physical body that enabled our spirit to grow. That physical self allowed us to learn how to love and learn how to be loved and grow in heart as someone with eternal beauty. The extent to which we can do that, this determines the degree of freedom and unfettered joy that we can experience in the eternal world. Many sermons, many spiritual writings, the pastoral poems, the nature-inspired art, they all express the extraordinary beauty of this world. And this alone can and has led people to an awareness of God. Of a being who is a universal presence with a purposeful mind and heart that lies behind everything. All creation, thinking, feeling, willing, acting, and loving. But we're reminded at times like this that that beauty of this physical world, as magnificent as it is, it's not the whole story. There is a spiritual world, and that is more vast, more beautiful, more extraordinary. It exists in more than four dimensions, which is something you just can't get your head around, right? So, and we all will find it, I'm sure, endlessly fascinating when we too go there. And all this spiritual dimension, which has an eternal quality to it, this is the manifestation also that has its origin in the heart and the mind of our Creator, our Heavenly Parent. You know, I don't think that our sister Susan will be so surprised by what she finds there. I imagine she will have immediately sought out people she knows who went before her. And in this new world she's experiencing, all people appear as if in their prime of life. Even those who lived many generations in the past look just like your brothers and sisters. So I think her beautiful heart will lead her to enjoy what she finds there, probably more naturally and more easily than most. You know, yesterday at Ashley's home, I was looking through a beautiful book of photographs that she had made, not so long ago, I believe. One struck me in particular. She's sitting under, I think it's an apple tree, And her face radiates such simple and genuine pleasure in the warmth of the sun and the kind of friendship or companionship of the tree. There's harmony there and there's peace there. It struck me very deeply because it's so simple, but here was a person absolutely appreciative of and at one with such a natural environment, and it was captured in a picture. Susan devised a very beautiful system to help people in our faith community find a partner in life where they would really suit each other. She invested a lot into that. I know I had the privilege to work with her in this area for almost 5 years in our blessed family department. One thing struck me, as plain as can be. She wanted happiness for others. She wanted happiness for others. And that's such a beautiful quality. I think it's almost like a definition of true love. And that's something which is in tune with the heart of the universe and with the heart of God. Now I'd like to invite our president of the European and Middle East region, that's Dr. Michael Balcombe, to share some special words of appreciation. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. You may have noticed just to the side of Susan's picture, a proclamation, a calligraphy in Korean and Chinese characters, which I think almost none of us can read directly. But what it says is that congratulations to Susan on having lived a life as a heavenly treasure. And I think it's very important this morning, in honor of Susan, to think about that term, a heavenly treasure. It's not because of something you do, although Susan has done so much, but it's really because of who we are, the sons and daughters of God, our heavenly parent. That means for sure that every one of us here is a heavenly treasure. But sometimes we forget that, don't we? We look at ourselves and we see where we fall short and we think, I'm no treasure. But that's wrong. To God, we are all so precious, so lovely, so beautiful. And so it's really important to treat each other that way. I think if Susan were able to speak this morning, she would say, love each other as the heavenly treasures that you are. Never forget how valuable and important we are to each other and to God. It's true that we're in the face of mystery. We don't know what the next world is like. We can't know. Father Moon once said, you know, it's for a baby in the womb, his mother's womb, small though it is, like a rice cooker, is the whole universe. For us here on earth, this world is everything we know. It's all right to not know. But it's important to remember who we are. Treasures of heaven, beloved by God. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Balcombe. We can have a moment now to reflect as we listen to a song. Are we ready for the song? This is a song whose melody Susan wrote herself, setting the words of Ye Jin Moon to music, and that's going to be offered by daughter Melanie with the help of Tom, and the song is called My Mother.
My mother, she brings many presents of love. Night after night, like Santa Claus. A warm heart, I can never forget it. It is in the night when mother comes with her love. Always she's busy, but she comes to my room every night. Sometimes she scolds me, then we cry together. I love my mother most in the world. Her beautiful heart, which is blue like the clear sky, can't be compared with anything. She seems to want to for good in every person. She is more beautiful than any flower. My mother is better than any other mother. Her heart opens everybody's heart to the beautiful and joyful world. And it can't but touch everybody's heart. And I wish to live in a heart forever.
So with that beautiful melody and very touching words settling in our hearts, let's hear a few personal testimonies. So if these would like to come up, just come up in turn. We'll hear first from Cecilia Fortune, such a close friend of Susan's, and from Amelia, you're over there. And lastly, it'll be her son Patrick and his wife. So, Cecilia, thank you.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. Sorry, I'm quite emotional, but I forgot my glasses. Hearing Melanie sing was like hearing Susan sing, and it really stirred up a lot. It was like I felt Susan and Melanie, they're one. When I heard them singing this song, it was really beautiful. First of all, I would like to read a few words which was sent from the Albanian family. Dear Crosthwaite family, Mr. Ashley, Patrick, Melanie, it is not easy to write these words to you on this occasion of Seonghwa ceremony of Mrs. Susan. Our hearts are with Susan and all of you. For many years, Susan was part of the Albanian movement's spiritual journey by loving, guiding, and supporting our members on the way to the blessing and after blessing also. Even though in distance, she was always there for us. Just a short message or a phone call, and she would always make time to listen and help as much as she could. We saw her as caring, fighter, visionary, hardworking daughter of God who resembled his image in trying to love and embrace everyone. Hundreds of Albanian members were educated and guided by Ashley and Susan on their journey to become blessed families who can inherit heavenly parents and true parents' love. We will miss the joyful talks with Susan, but surely she will have a much more important mission in the spiritual world, working with True Father and Heavenly Parent. We are grateful to all of you, her family, that supported her fully in her mission and allowed her to share time with us. On this special moment of Susan's life and your family, our heart and love is with you. May our Heavenly Parent embrace Susan in his bosom. On behalf of all Albanian brothers and sisters, Gabor and Manjola Vasmatic, and Gani and Marietta Roshi. I also want to share a few words. Susan and I, we met from the time we came to London. I can't quite remember exactly when, but I think our children naturally brought us together. Patrick and our firstborn, they are basically the same age. And Melanie is just a year younger than our daughter. So we very naturally spend a lot of time together and really got to know each other very deeply. And we often spoke about our Protestant ancestors. We felt they somehow, we shared something, Susan and I, you know, and our Protestant ancestors, they kind of, we often spoke about them and felt they were in our lives in many ways. So Susan, she was a person who was very excited about life. And she was always discovering new things. She had a very deep heart, and she really, like we've heard already, she wanted to help everyone. And she was always exploring further marriage, guidance, counseling, self-development, flag page, prepare, enrich, so many things, just continuous. And I was reflecting on her life and thought, what is it about Susan and me? And Susan was running. She was like always running, not literally running, but always discovering something new, exploring something new, finding something new, and wanting to share that with the world. And I was more passive maybe, and observing. And I was kind of she bounced all her thoughts and ideas off me many times. What do you think about this? What do you think about this? Yeah, I was kind of, So we shared a lot of wonderful moments together, and it's a real privilege, actually, when you come to see the person beneath the person, when you see not just what we all see, but you really start to see the depth and something really profound in a person. And I think I was very privileged to be able to witness that, and Susan shared many things. We shared many things together. There was a sisterhood there. And sometimes when you get to know somebody very deeply and very well, then there is also those moments where you feel a little bit distant, or you're not always close. But the bond is always there, and especially also Susan knew that she could always call me whenever she really needed, and there were times when Ashley couldn't be around and she called me and I could help with rubbing her back with some cream or ointment or different things like that. And it was like we didn't have anything to hide from each other. And it's very beautiful when you can have a relationship like that. So Susan has really given a lot to myself, enriched my life through our journeys together. We did, we both had this kind of desire to see how can we help people, and how can we, in very real, practical terms, sometimes the principle is very much words and faith, but how practically can we really support each other, be there for each other, and help each other? And when we did became emotion code practitioners at the same time, and we were guinea pigs for each other, and we had a lot of sharing going on and discovering many things, very beautiful moments. Maybe just to share a few I can't remember exactly time, I never remember, but it was after Susan had her fall and her accident, and she was a bit wobbly on her legs, not so easy, but she still had some loving living word books to post. So we slowly made our way through the local park to the post office. It was a beautiful warm day, it was just lovely, and then on the way back we sat down on a bench and just chatted, and it was really, really beautiful. And then also later, just recently, in her upstairs sitting room at home, she was kind of snuggled up in the blanket, and we had it was like a serene, very beautiful feeling, very, very wonderful time together, where, yeah, I really appreciate that moment. It's really a privilege to share moments like this with another human being. And at that time I felt there was really a warmth and softness about Susan, a mellowing and really softness, very beautiful. Susan was remarkable, and I know as she's surprised to have lived to this age, actually. Because she once told me that she didn't expect to live beyond 60, and she took every additional year with gratitude, and big surprise, I'm still alive, I'm still going, I'm still giving. And I think Heavenly Parent wanted her to be here as long as possible before she continues her work in the her new world. Franklin and I, we could visit on the Sunday before she passed. And at that time, she still looked beautiful. You know, it didn't look as if she would pass in a couple of days' time. not at all. So she's really remarkable. And I think what we've heard, when you have that kind of love in your heart, then it's there. It's in your, you know, you see it in your face. It's there. And she was, she looked well. I mean, she wasn't well at all, but she, her complexion looked very well. And then on Tuesday, I said to Franklin, no, I feel I need to go and see Susan straight after work. But then we got a visitor coming, so I didn't. And then after the visitor had left, I also Ashley sent a message. I saw a message from Ashley. And even though it was late night, I said, I just have to go now. And I'm so glad I did. And that was a profoundly precious moment for me to really just sit there, hold her hands and stroke her. And there's not much you can say, but just this aspect of being there and sharing love, it was beautiful. And I'm blessed to have had that moment. Thank you, Susan. Thank you for your friendship. Thank you for everything.
Over the years, Susan and I came to trust each other very much and shared at a deep emotional level that I didn't expect. Having lived very different lives, her living in Australia and doing many missionary works, and I growing up in the UK, and despite a 40-year age gap, we became very good friends. We both shared a passion for our love for life, and we both recognise the deep need for emotional healing in ourselves and society at large. One of Susan's greatest passions in her life was caring for people and finding new and exciting ways to reach people at their emotional need. She had spent many years and made it her life's work to support families, do couples counselling, working in Blessed Family Department and many branches of the Family Federation, and facilitating different therapies that support people to find a deeper sense of love, joy, and peace from within themselves. After exploring many different therapies, reading and attending workshops from psychologists and alternative therapists, Susan started her own work of what she calls now Core 3 Healing. She used this method to support members across the globe to connect with God, but that really means to connect with the overflowing deep well of love within themselves, to find resilience and confidence to encounter any situation they may face. After spending time with Susan on and off for 10 years, experiencing her different therapies, having a shoulder to cry on and a person who truly listened to me, one evening of October last year, we both had the same realization on the exact same day. She was to teach me her therapy and share it widely to anyone and everyone. She wanted to share it with those in the church, out the church, those who believed in God, those who didn't, those in pain, those lost. I was her pupil and she lifted me up as a level of her teacher, a teacher. She trusted me despite my many faults. She saw my challenges as strength of character, my failures as experiences to allow me to connect to people in a deeper way who have a shared experience. I say this to share about the type of person Susan is. She is patient, she is kind, she does not envy or boast, she's not arrogant or rude, and she always trusts, hopes, and persevered. Everyone that experienced her, her love, her therapy, experienced great healing and love. She gave me the confidence to support people in similar and the same work. The past year, We met regularly and we laughed, shared and cried together. She talked so fondly of her children, Patrick and Melanie. They were her greatest joy, and she would show me photos every week of them with a huge smile on her face, a proud mother. She loved her husband, Ashley, so much, and I feel privileged to have the chance to spend so much time with the beautiful Crosthwaite family. We will never forget Susan. In fact, she comes to us each day in our dreams, in our hearts. I have no doubt she is guiding her family in many ways that aren't obvious yet. She has planted seeds in people's hearts. Some have grown to beautiful flowers. Some we have yet to see grow. But one of the greatest things one can do in one's life is plant a seed of love in a person's heart. Thank you, Susan. Thank you for everything. Stay close because we love you. I love you, Susan. Thank you.
What can I? What can I really say about my mama? It's impossible to really put into words how much she meant to me and how much her actions informed my life. Even before I entered into the world, she was fighting for me, like she fought for many of you, all of you. For years, she tried to have a child and struggled so hard with loss and pain. I'll never be able to repay that debt. All I could do is my best, which is what she always taught me. To stay positive when times are rough, to never give up and never stay down. I guess you could say she was stubborn like that. Some might say that I'm stubborn too. I can only hope to live with the attitude that she had in life. I would like to share every story and every moment we had together. But there's no time for that. Nor can I remember all the precious moments. I wish I could. Maybe it's less painful that way. But I will try to share some things that came to me through the fog of time. And as I said, she always fought for me. When I started in school in the UK, I spoke Russian for the first year of my life. I don't remember now. Maybe that's why she found out I had dyslexia, back then it was maybe a big deal. I don't think it's a big deal anymore, because people have a lot of ways to help. I don't speak of it that much, and it's not a burden. But it's thanks to her that I don't feel like it's a burden. It didn't hold me back. I feel like I know how to spell better than some people. Anyway. She found me a private tutor, Diane Dreiker. I tried to reach out to her on Facebook. I couldn't find her. I don't know if she's alive still. She drove me every week to see her. She encouraged me to follow my passions. I sometimes felt that she was more engaged in those than I was. Yeah.
You know, I'd practice trumpet. I'd get frustrated and throw the trumpet on the ground because I had braces on, you know, it hurt. She'd pick it up again and say, you got to keep practicing. Yeah. One time, along with my first art teacher, she gathered some of my drawings. I used to draw superheroes, you know. I was a little kid. Not that little, but it was, I think it was primary school, yeah. She printed them with the teacher, and then the teacher helped bind them, and then she made copies, and she gave them to the whole class. It was very embarrassing. I think some, she kept some. I think there's one or two people that might still have them. But anyway, she was with me every moment trying to find a wife. And even when I had given up, that moment on Saturday, the 14th of February, is a miracle to me. I met my soulmate through an email one day that she started. And me and Ivana talked every day for a whole year over long distance, starting that day. That's because of her, she reached out. I also need to thank her that she became a special friend to Ivana over these 6 years. We called and we talked almost every week. We watched the Great British Bake Off over WhatsApp. Every season. We only missed this year. She loved you so much, darling. In her last moments, she opened her eyes twice. She saw us on the phone. I don't know, perhaps she was holding on to see us till the last moment. So I was working that day and Dad was calling me because we knew what state she was in. And we planned to visit Christmas. That's okay now, she's free. My only wish is that she could have seen her grandchildren. I want to thank my sister Belle that she was there for her in person when her brother couldn't be there in the flesh. Thank you, Mom. Thank you for everything. You know, during the weekend, we had sharings over and some prayers. It came to me. I can see, Mom, your spirit is here. It's like a blanket of stars covering you. It's a star in every heart, in every eye. Thank you, Mama. I will try to sing a short song. Forgive me if I stop. Oh, my love, my darling, I've hungered for your touch along the lonely tide. And time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much. Are you still mine? I need your love. Godspeed your love to me.
lonely rivers flow to the sea, to the sea, to the open arms of the sea. Lonely rivers sigh, wait for me, wait for me. I'll be coming home, wait for me. Oh, my love, my darling, I've hungered for your touch along the lonely time. Time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much. Are you still mine? I need your love. I need your love. Godspeed your love to me.
Thank you, Mom.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming. I am the extremely lucky daughter-in-law of Susan Crosthwaite. It's my privilege to read the testimony of her dear sister, Sally Stokes, who's her older sister in Australia. Good morning, Ashley, and the whole family. Thank you for being there for my sister. I'm sending my words about Susan through you. I was 5 years old when Susan was born. I remember being told to run down to Dr. Layden to tell him Mom was having the baby too early and she needed help. I sensed the urgency and ran past all the shops in our little country town to get the doctor to come. We saw this tiny little baby in the incubator, all of 2 pounds and 2 ounces, standing on an old fruit crate at the back window of the hospital was the only way we were able to see our newborn sister. But it wasn't long before she was taken to the city for some monitored intensive care. It seemed she was here 1 minute and gone the next, and it seemed forever until she was strong enough and big enough to come home. I didn't like the feeding tubes, but times had changed, and we had our dear little sister. Susan was so tiny, I was able to push her around like I would a doll. I wondered how long it would be that I could keep having her with me like that. As a toddler learning to walk, she was a lot of fun for me. My brother and I would hold her little hands and walk along with her, and every so often, I would move a little faster until she fell over and cried. Then I'd rush in to snuggle her and then repeat the process. A bit like the vinyl toy horse she had that we would knock off the top of the chair and just listen to her giggle. Her cheeks would go rosy, her curly locks would flop all over the place, and then she would take another breath. She had such a contagious giggle, beautiful smile, and lovely twinkling eyes. One day, I remember going out the back door, probably to swing on the clothesline, but it was blocked by this dear little mite enjoying some of the more slow footpath travelers. There were snail shells scattered up and down and a very messy face that I'll never forget. They were definitely the menu of the day. Susan also loved to sing and dance, as many of you would know, a wonderful gift. I watched her perform on the Good Ship Lollipop almost too many times to count. We moved to the city for a year, and I learned to catch the tram, pick up Susan from kindergarten, and get home at the right tram stop, a very different life to the one we'd known. Not long after that, our parents separated, and country life was ours again with another family. Boarding school for me, kinder, then primary for Susan. I only saw her during the holidays for many years, but our Sundays after church were mostly spent in the bush, walking and fishing. It was fairly idyllic and always looked forward to. As I finished boarding school, Susan started, and when she was 12, and when she was in year 12, I returned as a PE teacher and was able to share more of her life and watch her become a beautiful young woman. When she left school, she trained to be a nurse at the Royal Children's Hospital. I married, and after I had had my first baby and no bathing preparation for him, I panicked, and of course she came to my aid and gave me all the encouragement I needed to keep plodding along. Always the giver and carer. It was at this time too that Susan met some of the Unification family members and thus changed her life. Years passed, she met and married Ashley, and they began their lives together. Wherever they were in the world, we were able to stay in contact, and when the opportunity was there, we had visits, which became very special and now treasured memories. A lifetime shared is never long enough when we lose someone we love. Our memories of Susan will always be in our hearts to light up our souls and to make our lives shine brighter. Being surrounded by loving people enables her to have a full life, to be able to share her love, to encourage others, to listen to all, to understand, and to know what it was like to walk a mile in another's shoes. We are all blessed to have had her along on our drive-through life, and I know that her seat will have been left filled with warmth and love for the next traveler. Bless you all, and thank you for being part of my sister's life journey. Thank you, Auntie Sally. And I just wanted to say that I feel, as I said, very lucky to be the daughter-in-law of Mama Susan. I always called her Auntie Susan. I honestly really regret that. I should have called her Mom. Anyway. I will from now on anyway. Yeah, it's because of her, as Patrick said, that I'm in this family, and I'm very, very blessed. She was an amazing person, and I look up to her so much. And I think one thing I look forward to more than anything else is sharing how wonderful she was with her future grandchildren and watching her future grandchildren grow up and have little bits of her in them. Yes, thank you. I love you, dear Mom.
Thank you to you all. Let's stand now, invite you to stand, and we'll recite that third reading in the program, which is the Lord's Prayer. Let's recite this together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. I'm not sure if this is really a convention, but it's at a moment like this, I feel we should all give Susan a wonderful round of applause. Let's do that. Thank you. Please take your seats. This is the point in the program where it's the time and your opportunity to express your heart and love for Susan in a very simple way, but it's also profound, to offer a flower, a single rose. So I believe we have some flower bearers who are going to help. We need to do it swiftly and efficiently. So what I'd like to ask is that you make, starting with the family, we make two rows down the center aisle, and onto the, you'll be given a flower, and you can place it. Then two people at a time, you can place a single rose each on the altar, bow, and if you could, we could ask you not to linger too long, then part this way and go up the side aisles and back to your seat. So, and during that time, for those who are sitting, we'll continue to play the beautiful photographs. Isn't it wonderful? Yeah. I've been in another world while sitting there, and I listened to some music. So let's begin the flower ceremony.
Thank you.
The final part of the Seonghwa ceremony takes place at the Holy Oak Memorial Woodland. That's at Stanton Fitzwarren. So that'll be following this service starting at 3 p.m. Of course, it's quite a journey down there. So a reminder for those who are planning to go and to drive, then please leave your car at the South Farm unless you've given in your number plate already and have permission to go up to the soggy ground of the farm there. So that'll make everything go smoothly. Of course, if you need a lift because you can't walk, then that'll be arranged. I think you can talk to Simon Roselli about that, and we'll get you there. So we're going to sing a final song together, and at the conclusion of the song, I would ask the attendants to move the table and for the pallbearers to come forward, and ask everybody else just to remain standing until they've left the room. So let's sing. We have a song, I'll Never Leave You Anymore.
Yeah.
We will never leave you.